So welcome to the lecture of Louis Camnitzer here in the Künstlerhaus. For those who don't know what this hut is over there, we are within the exhibition of Paloma Vargas Weiss, and Rainer Haselhofer put this exhibition to the back, and so that we can have this wonderful situation for the lecture. And I want to thank, first of all, the Künstlerhaus to make it possible that we have the lectures this year here. This is the first lecture here in the Künstlerhaus under the title The Production of Meaning, and we will have three more here. And the idea is to ask, how does art, in a very general sense, produce meaning, and what is important for us is to look at that topic on a global scale. And we invited people from very different parts of the world and also with very different approaches to art to talk about this. I want to introduce you very, very briefly Louis Camnitzer. He's an artist living in New York, working in different, perhaps one can say, different media, like, or methods, like also creating and writing and teaching, but also, of course, all this for you is art, when I understood it correctly. And Louis is going to talk about the question, under others, what is an art, what is art, what is an artwork, what is a work, what is an institution. And he will be then after his lecture have a correspondent who is Raimundus Malaschauskas, who is giving the curatorial course right now at the SummerAcademy. So welcome with me, Louis Camnitzer, and thank you very much.
So this will be an experiment, and if it goes badly, it's Hildegund's fault. If it goes okay, it's my merit. And what happened is that I always read my papers to the public and never speak freely, in part because I won't remember what I think, in part because I digress, in part because I don't have control of time. And when I write it, I know exactly what I'm going to say and how I'm going to say it. But attention span of people is limited, and when something is read, people get distracted very quickly. And I think that's why Hildegund asked me to speak freely. And she did so based on her knowledge that I've been teaching for over 30 years, but on her ignorance of how I teach, which is throwing stones at my students and not giving them an articulate argument. So I was terrified of today. I arranged with Raimundus that he will bail me out when I run out of steam. And my wife suggested brilliantly that since I'm okay answering questions, which I hope you will ask, I should ask questions to myself. And so I made a list of topics that will help me along. The first question is, what's the role of curating, and why does it start so late in the career of people? And thinking about that, I figure instead of wasting the time of children, cutting little pieces of paper and gluing and smearing on paper with crayons, which is very good for the teachers and maybe fun for the children, but it doesn't have anything to do with art. Why not have the entry into that through curating and make curating the first step of approaching art rather than making? And the reason is that there's a confusion about art in terms of thinking that art is a craft and it's not a way of figuring out knowledge. It's not a tool of cognition. And therefore, children do things. The teachers call it art. Sometimes the parents call it art. The children have not a clue about what art is, and they never face that decision until it's way too late, and until they think that since they won't be competitive in the field, they better not touch it. And that's what we have today. So, right. I guess that's approval. So it would be, for me, although I don't have experience with children education, it would make more sense to have children organize the universe in two parts, into art on one side and what's not art on the other side, in a totally arbitrary way, without caring if that matches what we think is art or not. And therefore, they would accumulate stuff that in Kant's vision are useless objects, but that have the merit that they should be collected by the children. They can decide whatever criteria they want. Anything green and round is art, anything not green and not round is not art, and make a good collection of those objects. And then tell them, okay, now show them in a way that it convinces other people that this is art and is different to what is not art. And slowly from that, from basically a taxonomical exercise, start deciding and refining their own concepts of art. By not doing that, what we're doing is instilling one way or another a canon of values that determines what art is, which is predetermined, and which is confirmed by museums, and is presented as this is art, and therefore you respect it, and therefore you use it as a reference to do your production from there on, if you're good enough to do it. And that's a message given. So I feel that's a distortion of culture and a diminution of a cognitive process we should enter with total freedom. For me, a good museum would be like a good church, and not like a bad church. That is a church that helps heretics articulate their heresies and challenge the dogma, so that in that process they remain faithful and evolve their faith. Museum usually gives a canon as a given, and because things are in the museum, they are to be accepted as valuable, even if you don't have a clue what they are about. And that makes art indestructible of sorts. I have at home lots of art which I don't like, and I'm totally unable to destroy it. There's something to it. Maybe it's in the tradition of not being allowed to burn books anymore, that makes certain objects, even if you don't have anything, no relation with them, you still have to keep them alive. And that's an infraction of freedom. Not that I'm promoting burning books by any means, but I'm promoting a critical distance from the objects in which you're free to make up your decisions. So, second part would be, there is a contradiction already in the term artwork. One part you have art, which is not only a taxonomic thing, but it's a way of organizing knowledge. And the other part is the word work, which includes labor, which includes commerce, which includes trade, and which therefore puts a value into the object and diminishes the power of organizing knowledge. And museums are stuck with that. In part because they are not allowed to deaccess what they have, or it's very difficult to deaccess. So they have a lot of value, accumulated labor, on one hand, and they cannot sell it. And on the other hand, they have cognition, which is free and intangible. So what museums do is they charge you for peeking because they cannot charge you for the object. And that makes museums to expand on souvenir shops and on coffee shops and on circulation abilities, so that the more people that come and deal with the speaking, the more successful the institution is and the more money they can gather to enlarge the circulation of the museum. I like the notion of art thinking rather than art making. And art thinking, for me, is a meta-discipline. It puts art above any other disciplines. And ideally, it's a way of approaching knowledge that should permeate any other discipline. We are trained to think in terms of quantitative accumulations, of counting, of accountability, and of very limited relations of causality and of logic. And in art, we have all those elements, plus all the opposites as well. So in art, I can be logical and I can be illogical. I can deal with cause and effect, or I can deny it. I can suddenly believe in alchemy, although normally you're not allowed to do that. You are allowed to be superstitious as long as you don't harm people. And you have a broader scope of speculation that allows your imagination to go in any direction you want and not to stay in braces that only allow you to go in certain directions. So, in pedagogical terms, I would say that you would first start with the total, with trying to imagine in all directions, to have the main question of art applied to everything else, which is what if, which is a question that doesn't have any limit. And then from there deduce what do you need to use, what is going to be practical, how can you apply it to other things, and find also the fissures in scientific knowledge and see where you can redirect it in an imaginative way. So art thinking allows the artist to connect different systems of order that are not connectable in normal life. It allows the artist to deal with subversive orders, with alternative orders that are not allowed in normal life, and then test those systems of orders that are allowed and are conventions, and measure one against the other. And there are questions that normally are not asked, like, is order a subcategory of chaos, or is chaos a subcategory of order? And we're so orderly organized that chaos is the antipode of order and cannot be considered within the same category. And it's there where art thinking, for me, becomes a crucial element. And when I complain to Hildegard that I'm not a writer and a teacher and a person concerned with theory and an art maker, but I am an artist that explores in different directions, what I mean is that my notion of rigor is not conditioned by particular disciplines in which I change hats from occasion to occasion, but it is by this feeling of art thinking that encompasses all other ways of thinking. And there, when I propose a problem, I want that problem to be solved as well as possible within the broadest range of possibilities and not conditioned by particular techniques or media. Therefore, I'm totally against art schools that teach media instead of teaching cognition. So that's another issue. I feel that in art, like in science, there are also paradigms. Usually we don't think of the area of art as having paradigms. We just use our intuition, whatever that means, and our emotions and our feelings, and do whatever we please. And if we self-define as artists, it's art. And if we convince other people that we are artists, then it becomes more marketable art. But there's really no rigor except some kind of a consensus that is expanding, which makes the job of the artist really a job of convincing people that one is an artist and one is doing art. And that's more an issue of public relations than of cognition again. And I think there are paradigms in art, and I, even if may not be scientifically true, I identify three. One is realism, which is a long-lasting paradigm, in which we, in a caricature, would say, for every dot we see outside of ourselves, we make a dot on paper or on canvas in the right position, and therefore we more or less reproduce or represent what we're seeing. That's a paradigm that has been, with modifications, also with general figuration, has lasted for several centuries. And it's the one that causes that people say, oh, I'm not good for art. I don't know how to draw a straight line, which is a totally stupid statement, because you take a ruler and a pencil and you make a straight line. There's nothing, no law that says that you have to make the straight line just by hand. Great. So, the thing is that this quantitative approach is consistent with other quantitative approaches, and I think that's why it has or had currency for so long. And it's the same theory that you learn how to read by learning the letters and stringing letters together into words and words into sentences and so on. Or that you learn numbers and you learn how to string the numbers together and make them into formulas and quantities. It's really at odds with how we function, especially today, in which we're dealing with configurations, with fuzzy logic, with comparing patterns, and not with dots one by one as they are outside and we perceive them. It's interesting that because of that quantitative approach, we also believe that the more labor is invested and time is invested in executing a piece, the more value it has. And at the same time, we use Google and use search machines that price themselves in finding what you're looking for in a fragment of a second and not in years and years of research. So there's an anachronistic relation between how we are operating today with knowledge and how we are evaluating our labor. The second paradigm is, for me, conceptualism, which became current around the 60s, although there are precedents from way before, in which what became important was the general concept behind the work of art, and where the work of art becomes a solution to that problem. Suddenly, that puts art into away from labor and into a cognitive process. You're organizing knowledge one way or another and dealing with that knowledge, looking for objects that represent that knowledge. The third paradigm is functionalism, which we don't consider really an aesthetic, but it is an aesthetic. It is an administration of information in which you look for the minimal formal element so that the practical function of the object acquires the form. It's something that started with Lew Sullivan in 1896 when he declared that form follows function. And it has been accepted going through Adolf Loos, who declared that decoration is criminal, that anybody tattooing himself or herself is a criminal or a criminal to be, and that only those shapes that represent the function are the ones that should survive. With that, one good thing that happened is that we learn how to do elegant things. That is, how with a minimum of elements, we keep complexity and rule out complication. And that has been a contribution of functionalism and still will be valid for a while. The next thing is about teaching art. And in general, the position is that art cannot be taught. While art was just a craft, it was very simple to transmit the craft. Once art became identified with talent, what cannot be taught is talent. And the question is talent something worthwhile considering? Art schools tend to say yes, and therefore art schools require portfolios to select their students and decide on what's happening in a particular moment of the life of the student. Can we bet on that student that the future will be good or not? If the bet is against the future, the student is rejected. If the bet is in favor, the student is accepted. So in certain ways, this is institutional laziness, because those that are estimated to be good artists because they have talent probably don't need the school to begin with. And those that do not have that talent and do not have that process are the ones that actually do need education and need betterment. So it's not only a filter that favors the lack of teaching in a school, but it's also one that is derelict in terms of the social responsibility of what the school should be. And this deals with the general issue of meritocracy. We by now have internalized that schools should generate or identify the best people possible for society, which puts a distance between those that are successful in this process with those that are not. So we're creating a class division between people that are going to be successful and people that are condemned to be a failure because they're not getting the education they need. So while a good education would deal with bettering individuals, it really deals with identifying the best. And all that sounds good, but it's really a travesty. I like to throw stones at you. I mean, I am putting things in terms of caricature to see if I can shake you up. So I'm hoping that afterwards we will have a good discussion. The whole system of evaluation that goes with education, like PISA, and which I'm sure you know, are really tools of measurement of national success and not of individual development. So all the countries that use PISA as an evaluator are really after a national triumph and not after a betterment of society. So those countries that have better PISA rating consider themselves better countries and force other countries to follow. But the following is really creating a meritocracy. In those places like the US, where you have to pay for your education, an absurd amount of money, you're paying money for national pride and not for your own education. So you're basically being robbed of your money for the sake of a cause that has nothing to do with you as an individual. Okay, one problem I see with art education is actually the belief in art. The belief in art is somehow a confinement. And I wish that the word art would not exist. And instead, we would deal with the freedom of thinking creatively. And I did, some time ago, I made a mental exercise in which I figured what happens if we don't have the word art and we still have certain needs. And we would then commission somebody not to do a work of art, not to follow a canon that defines what art is for us, but we would commission something. And we would want then the person to work, or if I am the commissioner, I'm assuming I'm very rich and I can afford to employ somebody to work for me, and I'm lazy, I don't want to do it myself, and whatever it costs I can pay. So that person I would employ will have to be able to propose an interesting problem to be solved, one that preferably hasn't been explored yet by other people, one that reveals something that at least I didn't know and that therefore may be called original. So in other words, something that will expand my knowledge, which I think is one requirement of a creative activity. Second, that person will have to solve the problem in the most economic and elegant way possible, meaning that every part in the solution will be indispensable. The solution will have to fit the problem perfectly without digressions and maintaining complexity while eliminating complication. Third, the form given to the solution has to make it communicable. We want to understand on some level what's going on and what we're paying for. We also want other people to admire us for having commissioned the piece and contributed to culture. Then the execution of the piece has to be as perfect as possible. There shouldn't be anybody who could do it better, since we want the piece to be admired as a masterpiece. It has to be impeccable from the point of view of craftsmanship, of balancing precisely the needs and demands by both the problem and the communication required by the solution. Then we want the relation of the problem and the solution that it be as close to establish a paradigm as possible, so that, in other words, the piece should serve as a reference and become a starting point for subsequent creations. So basically that's what we should be looking for if we restore the word art. That's what the piece of art is about. And the most important part here is really based on how does that production relate to knowledge, and not how does that production relate to being an object in itself. And here I like to speak, I see as two kinds of dialogue that are established between, in reference to art. One is the old dialogue that has been occurring between the artist and the materials and the tools, and at some point with the art object. And that started as a craft-based relation and then slowly became as one that integrated neurosis and emotions and personal needs and convincing with the object, the public, that this all is very relevant. The second dialogue, which came around with conceptualism during the 1960s, is dialogue two, in which the concern was about how does that object communicate with the public. And the public there became the destination of a communicative process that could either finish in the public or start a new process. And as much as start a new process, it would generate creativity in the public and therefore help shape the cultural process and not just satisfy a market. We're now slowly facing a third dialogue, which is a scary one. I mean, the second dialogue is sort of utopian, but the third one is based on artificial intelligence and neuromarketing. And neuromarketing is amazingly, for me at least, an academic field in which marketing is not anymore based on psychology and on trying to outguess what public or the consumer would want to buy, but goes much further in trying to, through electronic devices, figure out where, bypassing conscious process, the person will accept or reject certain offerings. And one example of this is already in the makes by Amazon, which is patenting an algorithm that allows them to deliver you products that they know that you will want to buy before you order them. So you may find at your door an object that you didn't order, but once you open the package, you decide, oh, this is exactly what I want. And when that functions in art, which is probably the next step, then artists won't be needed anymore. The whole thing can be planned by algorithms and satisfy your consumer needs in terms of an art object. And Salzburg and our art schools will be able to close and start some other kind of business. So, I want now to talk about how I was taught, which was about 60 years ago, more. And I went to a school that was modeled after the French Academy of the 19th century. And I was put in front of Roman busts and asked to reproduce a bust in clay. And if I reproduced it well, I was good. Reproduced it badly, I was bad. What I could have learned, and in certain ways I did learn at the time, but nobody told me that I was learning it, is that the volumes in a face are non-Euclidean, and that there are toruses and other shapes that are not ruled shapes, and that the intersections are complex curves. And if somebody would have explained that to me when I was 16 years old, I would have been fascinated and interested and would have been able to draw conclusions that would have enriched my life. Instead, my next step after that was to copy life heads. And the next step was to do figures, and then the bigger the figure and the closer to reproduction it was, the better I was. So after 5 years of that, it took me another 5 years to unlearn what I had learned and to start doing the art I should have been doing. So that poses a question, why are art schools, and I think my experience, although it's extreme, is quite common, that is people that go to an art school really mature after they leave art school, after they unlearn stuff they learned, and they discover their own path. So why cannot be the education in an art school be constructive instead of being based on unlearning? Why can't we find a structure in which you add up knowledge in order to generate knowledge in a way that you need to generate knowledge for your self-development and the development of others? So I made a list of things that if I went back to school today, what would I want to happen in that school? It's an old-fashioned list because I'm 78 years old, and it will not match what you should be making as a list. But still, at least it may push you in some direction. So, number one, rather than becoming an erudite in school, I would want to learn how to access and organize information in the widest and deepest way possible to make sure that my erudition is fluid, ever-changing in my own terms. Second, since available information is infinite and ungraspable, I would want to learn about patterning, chunking, and organizing it, about connecting dissimilar systems of order, and about coding and decoding to communicate better whatever I wish to communicate. Third, I would like to be presented with disorienting dilemmas. These would force me to revise my assumptions and make unexpected decisions within a continuous learning process. By disconcerting dilemmas, what I mean is not to be presented with exercises that have one single solution, but that have either infinite solutions or that lead me to a point of being totally disconcerted, so that I have to reorganize myself in order to find my own order. Fourth, rather than be presented with problems to solve, I would like to learn how to rigorously formulate new problems to then go on and solve them. Five, I would like to learn about what forces make the canon a reference, how to question those forces and the canon, and how to develop my own criteria for quality control instead of being told what is best so that I am free to generate new knowledge. Six, I don't want to focus primarily on the manufacture of objects. I want to use art as a way of looking at the world rather than as a way of looking at art. I want to be able to understand the interaction between objects and context and learn to perceive, analyze, use, and affect context I would want to include. I would want to include anthropological and sociological perspectives to have the broadest understanding of what context is. Seven. I want to become precise in the transition of discovery or working without knowing what I'm doing and the use of the discovery of communication. Eight, I want to become aware of manipulation, both how I'm being manipulated and how I manipulate others. I want to learn from specialists in advertising how to construct my work to manipulate viewers to react appropriately to my work, and how to do so with full ethical awareness. There's one thing here, which is that while in more traditional fashion, we learn about palette, about harmony, about composition, and all those are instruments that we take as positive statements, we don't realize that in fact they are tools for manipulation, and that by using them we are guiding the viewer to look in a given way. We want the viewer to look at the work in a given order, how the work should be read. And that's manipulation. So there's nothing wrong with manipulation. It's wrong if we don't take responsibility for manipulation, or if we use manipulation in an unethical way. And what's interesting is that if you study medicine, you usually are forced to take courses in ethics. Since you are intervening in the body of other people, you have to be ethical about how you do it. And ethical here is a sort of flexible word, but sometimes it gets confused with morals that are determined institutionally and not by yourself. But in any case, I'm being punished. What's puzzling is that in art, you are not intervening usually with the body of the public, but you're intervening in the minds of the public. And that should be ethically accountable as well. So it's beyond me why there are no ethic courses in art school, while there are ethics courses in medical school. So something to think about. So, 9, I want to have some foundation in psychology to help me know better my interlocutors and to address my perception and that of my public. I want to know how to process information and be able to fine-tune its organization for effective communication. 10, I want to study art history, but do so starting from the present, going towards the past. I want to be aware of my own cultural projections onto the past. I want to understand as closely as possible what the conditions were that generated the artworks we study, and be able to see what parts of old artworks are still relevant today. 11, I would like to learn technical skills in relation to the problems I'm working on. These may be either known skills or new ones I will have to invent to do the work myself, or to be able to correctly delegate tasks. I would like to do this without the feeling that existing techniques limit me and are my enemies. 12, I want to work in art understood as a form of higher order thinking that enables me to formulate and solve problems and to produce appropriate objects and situations to communicate the solutions. I want to be a competent craftsperson and manufacturer where this is needed. Be someone who exercises quality control with maximum rigor. Be in charge of production as a self-employed laborer or as an employer, and be able to wisely administer the resulting products. And 13, I want to be able to be ecologically sound, not only in terms of physical and chemical pollution, but regarding the moral and political consequences of my actions. That is, have only pieces survive that I consider are indispensable, and be clear on why I consider that they shouldn't be destroyed. So, to finish, there's a lot of art pollution going on, and the reasons are that a lot of things we do as artists is not art. A lot of things we do are done because we don't have a clue what art is exactly, and we're exploring by making what might art be. And those things usually are useful as first steps on the ladder, but do not really matter in terms of getting to the top. So we have to learn that just because we're artists, not everything we do is art. The same as just because somebody is a scientist, not everything they do is science. There's a much more rigorous selection among scientists than among artists. I think that's something we should start correcting. Thank you. And now, Raymond.
It's an open term, and this is what I really like in your thinking, that it's about bettering of society. So that, like, seeing artist's mission as a sort of like a social mission. And myself, I studied in art school, and when I finished it, I suddenly realized how the world became much more interesting. And it was increasingly becoming more and more interesting. And it was because I was not in school anymore. Mm-hmm. However, it was happening through art. So that meant that art was this sort of like operational software that was making the world to enlarge. And I think it probably still does. But in that case, I also, like, I don't see art as a goal or a purpose at all. To me, it's just a way to make more of the world. And how to turn that into, let's say, an educational, I wouldn't even say system. You often mention rigorousness, which, let's say, to me, makes me think a bit about system. Do you really mean a system, or? When you talk about
I missed the word before.
Rigorousness.
I think the rigor in art is different to the rigor in science. And that one of the reasons is that in science, you usually have a problem and you look for a solution, and if you find it, you're fine. In art, you sometimes find a solution first, and then you go and look for what problem fits your solution. So you have a bidirectional flow, which is much more open, and that allows you for feedback and forward back. It allows you for actually including dialogue one, talking to your material. It puts you in an ethical decision situation in which you have to decide how much control do you exercise over tools and material, how much do you allow material and tools take control of you, and it's a pendulum that has been oscillating over a long time. And today I was thinking that like Degas, Monet, Renoir all died between 1910 and 1920 or so. And abstract expressionism is 40s and 50s. So there's a span of only 30, 40 years in that range of aesthetics. Okay. I went to art school in 1953, and today we're in 2015. So my distance is much bigger than between de Kooning and de Gaulle, between how I started and how I'm ending. And that gave me pause, and that's why I'm cautious about my list. I don't know how valid my list is today, because it's a long half century that I listed. But I think as long we have an open definition of rigor, as open as possible, but are aware that we need the rigor, instead of going into the individualistic, narcissistic attitude that I'm an artist, this is art, and you have to accept it because I'm an artist. And that's not so. This happens to be art because I organized the space, which actually was a comment that made me shift from my interest in chemistry to go into architecture. And I was telling Hildegard today that when I was in high school, around 15 years old or so, our teachers, they were not full-time teachers, but they were professionals. So at that point, we got lectures of our teachers about their professions. And the math teacher was an architect. And I went to his lecture, although I was interested in chemistry. I was not interested in architecture, just because a classmate told me, come listen to this guy. So it was raining, it was windy, it was a lousy day, and we were sitting there waiting for the guy, and the guy came like 10 minutes late, slammed the door open, took his raincoat off, took his hat off, threw it on the desk, and then approached the desk and said, this is architecture. And that is what made me drop chemistry and go to architecture. Then I dropped it much later, but that's another story. Okay, but there was a rigorous thought behind his hat. He was not crazy, he was incredibly lucid, only we were too young to perceive it.
So it's almost like it was like a distinctiveness of a concept. That's how I understand the rigorousness.
Well, and the need, that is the connection of problem and solution, no matter how you establish it, has to be done in a way that you cannot pull it apart anymore. So it has to be indispensable suddenly. You have to be impoverished if that disappears. That's the rigor.
What is the process of that rigorousness?
It's being inside the process and outside the process at the same time. It's like swimming underwater while you're standing out of the pool, watching yourself swimming underwater. That's what should be taught in art school.
Being a hologram, in a way. It's interesting also, like I was spending some time last week with dancers, and contemporary dancers, they also talk a lot about being critical mm-hmm. about their practice, but at the same time being completely involved in it and performing it, being in their own body and doing it. Mm-hmm. At the same time, like being distanced to it.
Yes.
Where like, so that sort of like distance becomes even more acute than, let's say, with probably like art world people, mm-hmm. which is much more disembodied.
Yeah, I agree.
And it was interesting also that you were mentioning the neuroscience and neuromanagement in a way.
Neuromarketing.
Yeah, neuromarketing, exactly. Because these are like huge topics, artificial intelligence and neuromarketing. Let's see if there are, I think, many philosophers who in a way find their like ultimate mission to produce some parameters of artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. And that means completely like bypassing the body to produce an intelligence that only works as a sort of algorithm, the assemblage of algorithm. Mm-hmm. And with the neuromarketing, it's also completely passing by the
conscious.
Right. These are also like super interesting, I think, moves that are happening.
Yeah, what's also is that, I mean, this neuromarketing started in the 90s in Harvard. And for me, it's clearly an unethical area. And nobody is.
And I know because
on the contrary, there are about, I think, 10 universities already around the world that have it as a normal process, normal discipline, or major to major. I never read anything criticizing it.
There are some books. Yeah. I think it's happening, like, because it is a, I mean, it's an ambivalent phenomenon.
Yeah.
Like, you are also saying you are interested in manipulating mm-hmm. and being manipulated. Mm-hmm. So I think neuromarketing is just like a sort of another register of how it is happening.
Yeah, but look, if somebody makes an ad for cigarettes, I consider that unethical manipulation. And the better the ad, the more unethical it is. But ultimately, it kills people. Okay? And it doesn't matter if it sits on the box or not. It kills people, period. Therefore, no ethical advertisement designer should engage in doing that. And there are people criticizing that. This here. But it's not the manipulation that's wrong. It's how the manipulation is used. If I talk louder so that you hear me better and choose specific words so that you understand me better, I'm manipulating my message to get to you and ultimately convince you of what I'm saying. Okay, that's manipulation. Now, I can convince you or try to convince you of go and kill that lady in the first row. And yes, you. And if I do, I am being unethical in my manipulation. Okay? Or I can convince you, no, give her a euro so she buys a Coke. There we're in sort of the middle ground of ethics. Or whatever. Okay. So it's there where the ethics come in to determine how are you using manipulation and not hiding it with euphemisms or condemning it at large, because that would be hypocritical. From the moment we open our mouths, from the moment we dress, from the moment we use body language, we are manipulating because we are presenting an image, trying to convince other people of something. So it's what we're trying to convince about that determines if we're ethical or not.
Do you remember how you came to ethical thinking? Because it must have been like some, I don't know, maybe a long process or maybe some kind of breakthrough?
No, actually. I was lucky enough when I entered art school, the predominant ideology in art school was anarchism. And an anarchism that I now have to always qualify and say was ethical anarchism, and not just anarchism, because anarchism is being used as synonyms of terrorism and sort of negative stuff. But ethical anarchism is basically Bertrand Russell, Herbert Reed, Bernard Shaw, Fabianism, Martin Buber, a lot of people that are beloved and respected were ethical anarchists. So that was the ideology prevalent in art school. And that actually helped me a lot, because the whole speculation about the relation of power between tool and artist started then. and I was a lousy draftsman, for instance, and failed my drawing exams. I was okay with clay, but I was bad with pencil, which was puzzling, because basically it's the same administration of infinite of dots. And I figured out at some point that when I had to draw, I had to lie. And when I had to work with clay in three dimensions, I was telling the truth of the way I perceived. So in trying to recreate something three-dimensional in two dimensions, and something that had color in black and white, I was lying. And at home, I was educated, you never lie. And I was in an age in which that created a crisis. So ethics was part of my evolution. And since I was a bad draftsman, at some point I realized if I give more latitude to the pencil and let it do what it wants, those drawings will declare me as a very clumsy draftsman, but the result will be viable. And suddenly I was draftsman, and I actually lived for a couple of years doing illustrations in a newspaper and doing the political cartoons in my clumsy way. Okay? So all that, plus the politics involved in the student body in the university in Uruguay, all across was highly politicized, as in most of Latin America. So political issues connected with ethics also were very important. At some point, my generation had decided, okay, we should not do art of our own until the moment that everybody can do art. I mean, which was a stupid statement, but we believed it at least for a couple of years. And today, I would say, consistent with that evolution, that for me, actually, ethics is the main issue. That politics is the way of finding strategies to make ethics possible. And art is really, in a distant third place, the way of implementing those strategies. And art is there, not because it is the instrument, but for purely accidental biographical reasons, which are of no interest to anybody else. So it so happens that in my personal case, I am doing this using art, somebody else may be doing making shoes, it doesn't matter. But the order of importance is that. One, ethics. Two, politics, not in a partisan way, but in a game strategy way. And whatever you choose to use as an instrument to do it, you choose, as long as it's the best instrument you can do. And for me, art was the best instrument, and not chemistry.
So that's amazing. So you've been working in an ethical way all your life, because this is how it sounds to me.
Give or take some.
Yes. Good family education.
Yes.
Because I often find interesting when, let's say, artists say that, yeah, I've been like in, you know, aesthetic period for the last 10 years, and I think now I will sort of switch into my ethical period.
Well, that's sort of absurd, yes.
I think we are happy also to... I felt like when I was listening to your lecture, I thought, the complexity is going on. Now it's my turn to be that complication. But I think now we're back to complexity of all of us. Do you have questions and comments and statements?
Come on, Sabine, attack me.
I knew what you were thinking. So can I ask you, Luis, since I know you work a little bit, how does this go, what you were mostly considered to be a Duchampian? Would you say that at the end, that
art has to be selective, like in relationship to evaluation of science. I'm surprised.
It has to be rigorous.
Pardon me?
It has to be rigorous.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be accidental. I don't think that's a contradiction.
Well, but Brujon had the idea that the context defines or determines what is art.
You look at the context. The context is a box, a resonance box. And I totally agree the context is fundamental. In fact, when the term conceptual art came about as a label, I didn't like it for myself, and I called myself contextual artist, not conceptual. And I figured that what it was about is to find ways of creating leverage and multiplying the power of whatever I was doing by using the resonance of the context. So you only can do that if you analyze the context, and that the term is usually your political strategy.
Yes, of course, the sheer existence doesn't turn something into something specific, that's for sure, but just thinking. Maybe that's the ethical, post-ethical period you're into.
What would be a post-ethical period? it sounds good, but...
Thinking about my talk tomorrow already, probably, yeah. Well, Louis had developed certain strategies, thinking about the printmaking group and all kinds of things. You did work in specific media also in your...
Yeah, but it was about freeing myself from those media. So, yes, after sculpture, I did printmaking. And then I realized printmaking is living in Rembrandt's time and never evolved. And industry, meanwhile, took off. And the Warhol pillows you have in the show were like a symbol of what printmaking could be.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Warhol is one of the few artists that came from a printmaking vision and contributed to culture. I don't consider him a painter. I consider somebody who was embedded in thinking about editions, one way or another. And those pillows were like the cleaning up of all the garbage traditional printmaking has. So, and that happened about the time I was trying to get rid of printmaking in my thinking. So until then, I was a printmaker trying to make art instead of being an artist using printmaking when it was needed. And that took a lot of unlearning to get to that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not denying the technique, it's just putting it in the right place. And ultimately, we're talking about packaging. And technique is the tool to package what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So it shouldn't be the beginning. First, you should know what you're doing.
Okay.
And then you're done.
So maybe you want to relate that to your pedagogical group you told me today about?
Well, I'm now more interested in education than in making art. I mean, I probably always was and happened to make stuff too. But I'm interested in, I think art appreciation, the way we normally understand it, is a form of vandalism that vandalizes the art you're supposed to be appreciating. And therefore it should be proscribed. It's a way of developing consumerism and not developing knowledge systems. So what I think should happen is, instead of looking at art or looking through art for other knowledge, you have to look around art and understand or attribute reasons for which that object of art exists and why might it be important. And the importance then is not anymore because art history is selling it to you, but because the problem that generated that piece has validity and importance. And with that, I am interested in giving exercises that are disconcerting dilemmas, if possible, that allow whoever is confronted with them to develop their own solutions in whatever discipline they want to, art or not. And without knowing what artwork generated that situation. And only after those exercises are executed, then they will be confronted with the work that caused all this. And at that point, the person that did the exercises will be in the same creation process of the artist, and therefore be a colleague of the artist and not a consumer. In that process also, the canon will be identifiable. In this moment, the canon is given, and it's invisible usually. So learn to determine that a piece is good, but you don't know why it's good, because you didn't participate in the creation. And it's not a matter of doing a better work or worse work. It's a matter of imbibing yourself with the thinking, with the art thinking that is behind it, and understand that. And education shouldn't be about creating star artists. Education should be about liberating people. And art is one way. And art has the advantage that you are more likely to touch the unknown. Call it mystery, call it magic, call it whatever you want. But technically it's that you are going beyond the wall of knowledge into an area that is not yet known. And we call it whatever we call it. And that, in art, you have the freedom of pushing that wall. And you have the horrible Sisyphus syndrome, that once you move that wall, it becomes part of knowledge. So you have to move the wall again. And that's why art is so addictive. You never get the ball to the top. But it's about that. It's not about, oh, I like this, let me buy it, put it in my living room.
Can you give an example of an artwork?
Voice, please.
Oh, sorry. Can you give an example of an artwork that, and of the, I mean, I don't know, perhaps this is stupid, but what is the problem, how it is solved, and how do you push, what is the knowledge, and how do you push the limits of knowledge?
Well, I think Duchamp is a good case study, in which, on one hand, he didn't really make artworks, but he created games that he played very well. But what we get is the game creation and not the object. And then he helped us the designation, that he gave us the freedom of determining, okay, this now is art, and focus on that. So that puts you in the process of thinking in artistic terms and not of making something that has to fit some criteria. In my grade, there's another example in which he basically created a visual system following Saussure and gave us the freedom of nomenclature. And things can, nomenclature is arbitrary, and we have the power of using that arbitrariness to establish our own order. So that's another one. And then you have those that touch on poetics, not on poetry, but on poetics. So there are many examples. But for instance, I have an issue with Michelangelo. And I don't understand him. I honestly don't understand him as a work of art, which means I can admire him as an incredibly precursor in terms of how he worked, how he applied skills. But I don't understand the problems he was solving. Or if I do understand them, they are not relevant to me. And yet, there is a legacy of forcing us to accept him as an ultimate sculptor, or Picasso as an ultimate painter. And it was interesting, I once was in the Prado checking out Guernica, which is a painting I never had much appreciation for. I always found it a very decorative painting. And pompous in the sense that the politics were narrative, but not more than that. So I said, okay, by now this is a prejudice I have, I will go and check. Then went quite close, went like a meter from the painting. I was surprised that I was the only one looking at it. At some point I turned around and saw that there were maybe 50 people about 15 meters from the ring, which was the exact distance you need to take a good photograph with a wide angle and a shoot, what we call a power shot, and which actually declared the failure of the painting. So that was. So there's a lot of selling going on. And it doesn't matter if I'm right or not with examples I'm giving, but definitely art history sells us things that we may accept or not accept the sales, but we have the power to do that. We don't have to just accept it.
Thank you very much. I was working with the topic of art knowledge for a long time when I realized that I don't even know anymore what art knowledge really is. And I think it became a little bit clearer now for me. And thank you for that. I have a question about education in this setting. So not necessarily the education of artists and curators, but of the viewer, of the visitor, or of a museum, or the viewer of the artwork. And so like the things you propose, it sounds like it would take a really long time for us to get to the stage where everyone can have access to art knowledge and art thinking. And I wonder if you have an idea how to, or if you have like a notion how to bypass or accelerate this process for the viewer who may be never really in a position to get access to art knowledge, because it is, art is maybe deemed not really necessary in our society. Or like on a certain level, people don't think it's necessary enough for everyone to have access to art knowledge. And I wonder if your resistance to quantification might be like not a problem, but maybe like if we wouldn't resist quantification in this setting, maybe we could bypass or accelerate art knowledge for the viewer, in a sense that I'm thinking about space, like the space where art is presented, like some sort of instant knowledge in the space that we wouldn't have to acquire through education. If you think that it would be in any way possible, or if you have like a total resistance against that.
I didn't fully understand the quantification part, but
yeah.
One of the problems of the educational system, as broad as you want to define it, is that it tries to evaluate quantitatively qualitative issues. And I don't think you can do it, or if you can do it, I haven't found out how it works, but would like to find out. And maybe it is possible if there are enough variables that compensate the quantitative distortion. So I'm not putting it as an impossibility. But certainly grading is not a way in school, and certainly declaring something good is not a way either. In terms of art itself, you have several problems. One is that Western art, as we, let's say, learned art, as we call it, as opposed to popular art or folk art, works a lot on references. It's very self-referential in terms of field. So a lot of work refers to art done previously, and if you don't know that, then you're in trouble. It's like reading French philosophers today, in which each word has another word behind it, which in turn has another word as an explanation. And if you don't know the whole telescopic development, you end up a little bit in a void. So that's why I don't read them. But you have that art, as we are discussing it, is really a cultural manifestation made for a tiny fragment of the population. And it's a population that is educated, that is middle class and up, that has a certain level of economic income so that they can pay, according to the country, the tickets to go into the museum, and so on. So there's already a filter there that determines that communication is possible. And those that are not addressed by that art don't even come to the museum. So there's a self-selected filter that takes care of that. So now comes the question, how do you break down that filter and go on? And that is something, well, a museum could help if instead of having the educational department as a public relations office and the curatorial department as a high-powered thinker, if they would merge and have the education department work together with the curatorial department and evolve the show at equal rank. And then we would have one step forward. And that's not impossible. And I actually had a good experience with that, which if you want, we can discuss. So that would help. And the other thing that would help is if the whole educational system would change and adopt art thinking as the basis.
But that would take a long time.
Yes. But I don't think we should believe in instant gratification. And I mean, I was very much in favor of revolution when I was young. And I now realize that revolution was really based on consumers' instant gratification. That revolution wins and the whole system suddenly is good and everybody's happy. It doesn't work that way. In my country, it didn't work at all that way. And in fact, revolution was declared dead after a certain amount of years, but the people that were in that revolution, although they spent a decade and a half in jail, are now in government. So 40 years later, the revolution won. And what that meant is that our watches were not timing things correctly. And maybe the solution is not in our generation, but five generations later. But that shouldn't preclude that we should start working on it.
Just to follow up on your issue, so with understanding my thing with quantification. This actually relates to Gilles Deleuze, and he and Stephanie wrote a book on Kafka, and in the very end, in the last paragraph, there is a very peculiar quote where they say, if you want to quantify Kafka, you have to practically rewrite it to go through all the motions he did. And this inspired me to think about how we could maybe use like some sort of quantification or engineering in the space to actually make people have like some sort of effective not knowledge yet, but some sort of access that would interest them into in getting this knowledge. Because I feel like there's a lot of frustration with art. People who are not educated about it are often really frustrated when they go to a museum and they are confronted with art and they don't understand why it's there. And that doesn't make them ask about like what art is or what it should be or anything, but it just makes them feel stupid. So that is like my main issue, and I wonder how we can just like kickstart in the viewer now something that would also maybe lead to ask the question to education to actually change towards incorporating art knowledge, art thinking into education.
Well, I think that the show could present the problem that generated the piece, and that the public can relate to the problem and then decide if the piece fits or doesn't fit according to their knowledge. And very often you can find references in a work of art that even if it refers to other work of art that was done previously, it also refers to quotidian experiences through which you provide other entries. So I don't think it's impossible. But in any case, it's not the public that is stupid. It's a museum that is stupid, that's not finding a way to communicate.
Okay. But on the other hand, I don't think it's a problem to feel stupid also.
It's a problem for the people.
No, but I think the state of feeling stupid is quite an interesting one.
Yeah.
And I think it should be not like totally underestimated and,
yes,
and
exactly.
Sort of like abandoned, not to be explored.
No.
You see, the other problem you have, not you, but we have, is taste. And I don't like it, and you don't look at it. And I like it, and you do look at it. But in fact, what you're doing by applying taste as an evaluator is you're using your comfort to determine if something is good or not, and you're not allowing your knowledge to evolve. And that's the function, the real function of the educational museum, is to develop knowledge, not to refine taste, which is what they mostly do.
Hello? Okay. I've got a question regarding the ethical criteria for an artwork. You have said an artwork which causes the death of people is unethical. I imagine a Syrian artist before the revolution, during Assad regime, and he does or she does an artwork which encourages people to revolt. So they do the demonstrations and the revolts, and this revolt leads to the war, which kills a lot of people. So would you judge such an art? How would you judge such an artwork?
Tell me again,
what's
that trouble?
Syrian artists,
yeah,
encouraging people to demonstrate against Assad,
yeah,
and then people get killed in the demonstration. Would you judge that artwork on the ethical terms that you
want? Well, I wouldn't call that artwork.
Mm-hmm.
I begin with, so the essays wouldn't apply to Zarco. And I don't think anybody should die, period. So I think it's probably a lack of imagination to try to use brute force for protests that you know beforehand that will cost heavily. And there are other ways of protesting that will not cause deaths and may be more efficient. And ultimately, a protest is also an educational process. You don't want to, I mean, in some ways, it's actually a stupid procedure because you are minimizing your army by sending it to die. So it's not only unethical, but it's stupid. So you have to analyze how can you maximize the energy potential you have with the fewest casualties possible. I don't know how else to answer. I mean, I never would encourage people, oh, go and face the machine guns, because we have to express our disagreement with the regime. First, we'll sit down and say, how else can we do it and preserve as many lives as we can?
There was one more question there.
Oh, thanks. It's not so much a question, but just a comment. Have you published your list of your qualifications or questions, which I think is 12 or 13, if you went to a university? Only the other reason I ask is because I think that it gives, those questions give a lot of agency to students that I think they don't really have or is systematically being taken away from students, especially I'm from the US, so I feel a lot of the time questions are sort of asked of me instead of me asking questions myself, which is okay, but I'm curious if these questions you publish.
Again, I don't know. I have hearing aids.
The question is basically if you have published those statements that you were reading at the end.
Oh. No, not yet, but I will.
Good. The other one was the idea of alternative education, which has been a lot on my mind as the government in the United States cuts funding for universities and sort of deems it to be less about educating the public as more educating people that have money. So I'm thinking of maybe someone like Ivan Rogoff, who's writing about alternative education in other places, like in Paris and I think in London as well. Do you see something like that maybe in the US happening as we go forward, especially now in the political climate that we're in?
In the US I see class stratification system that is very powerful and that is slowly taking away any empowerment of people that don't have money and preserving it for those that have it. So it's a process of strengthening the oligarchy and weakening the people that work for that oligarchy. So I'm not that hopeful. I mean, unless education becomes a right, civil right instead of a commodity, like it is in other countries, that's a lost cause. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it ever would be solved, especially not if Trump becomes president.
I mean, I think the one thing that I might be hopeful and maybe a little romantic about is the notion that art might have the power, or young people might have the power to, restructure their education for themselves and to come together and really decide the kind of education that they deem to be what they want, right? So your list is very empowering.
No, I agree, and I am very much in favor of social journalism structures, but you have a market problem, that is, the accreditation system is what gives credibility when you look for a job, and not your life trajectory and what you did with it. So until that is broken, you don't have a chance. You may be a terrifically self-educated person, but if you don't have a good diploma to prove it, it's really worthless on a statistical level. It may work on some particular cases. But ultimately, good education is actually self-education. I think autodidacticism is the only thing that works, and a good education should enable people to be good autodidactic people, because that's a process that escapes the educational structure and keeps going through all of your life. And that's an ideal situation. But I don't know of any university in the US, which is where I taught, that takes responsibility for creating autodidacts. It creates, takes responsibility for making dependent subjects of what's being taught, so that they deserve, in a quantitative way, in a show of grades, a good diploma that in turn would be an entry to a well-paying job, according to what, how much money they spent for their studies and work. And that's a very diseased process, which needs major revision. I don't know if it's possible. The advantage of art education, actually, if there is one, is that in a hidden way, it does stimulate autodidacticism. So there is a chance there. It's less frozen than other disciplines. The difference between educating and training is more present in art, even if you learn how to paint.
Yeah, I'll just say that a friend of mine said, you know, as a scientist, I couldn't be an artist, but as an artist, I can be a scientist, and that really resonated with me. So, thank you, Liz.
She wants an L.
So the way that you talked about manipulation and ethics places artists in a very crucial position in our society. And I was wondering what is, in your opinion, the role of an artist in our society?
What is what?
The role.
Role.
Subversion. And by subversion, I mean showing the spuriousness of certain orders that keep society oiled instead of self-analyzing and changing. And I think art as a tool to expand knowledge, which it does by subverting order and mixing orders, is the perfect potential tool to do that.
I think you talk about an art which needs, which is linked with to courage, isn't it? I mean, to courage, when you say you want to liberate people, it is to get them out of the system of consuming, and to get explorers. But this is, can never be without courage, you see? This kind of ethics needs courage.
Any kind of ethics needs courage. Not just in art.
And this is what I often miss, you see, courage in art.
Yeah, I mean, society is basically favors submission, not dissension.
Repetition or
not? No, that's submission.
Shall we have the last question? Or the one before the last? I had one, like you were talking about disorienting, and it's the same question that I asked today my new friends of the workshop. And the question was very simple, like, where would you like to be lost most?
Lost.
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 I know, it's a tricky one, because you know why.
I'm fine at home.
Thank you.
Last question. Way I'm thinking, I understood is of course a major issue. But I wondered in technique, you said that it took you a very long time to get rid of the printmaker's attitude. And I wonder, is it would for you be a way of training people, so to say, into a way of art thinking by more or less trapping them with technique, so that you trap them, teach them technique, and by teaching them, you guide them into the way of art thinking? Would that be acceptable for you?
Look, if I base art education on techniques, one big discussion I had in my college when we started organization, I was there from the beginning, and I lost immediately. I tried to point out that there are two models for college. One is a pearl necklace, and the other one is the aleph. The pearl necklace means that each discipline or each topic in the universe is a pearl, and you keep adding it to the necklace, which means you end up with a necklace of infinite lengths, and even then, you still are missing. The Aleph is, the model was based on a story by Borges, which I don't know how many of you know, in which a writer, a very mediocre writer actually, had in his home, on the stair, no, not Borges. No. Borges actually was using the mediocre writer to make fun of the mediocre writer. No, careful there. He was Argentinian, but he was okay. This writer had on the third step, I think, of the stairs going down to his basement, if you sat down in a given position, you would see a little ball of about 2 centimeters diameter in which all the images of the universe would be contained simultaneously. And that story is from 1930 something. So it was way ahead of any hologram conception or any configuration thinking. I mean, it's an amazing story. If you didn't read it, go immediately and get it and read it. But what it meant is that a good pedagogical system, a good educational system, can take any minute element and from there deduce the universe without any fragmentation or interruption. And I felt that a college that is well designed, especially a liberal arts college, as that was, should have an ambition to cover all of knowledge and not to cut it down into little slices. And then we were talking about the full pie or a full cake for the student and not just a couple of slices in which nobody knew what was in the other slices. And, well, the rest of my colleagues were all obsessed with their own field and territory. And the school immediately went into departments and little fractions that were focused on. See, I had been hired to make an art department, and I was the only one that refused to have a department. I wanted to be in all classes in the college and give the art point of view.
and enrich what they were doing in a fragmentary way. And this was in 1969. And it's amazing that today it's still considered an odd way of thinking. For me, it's the only way of thinking.
Thanks a lot.